The questions that we need to be asking are rather questions about any act we take. Does it empower? Does it empower me? Does it empower the person who's connected to whatever I am doing?
Humans can be amazing, compassionate creatures, and we can also be evil, short-sighted beings. And the question is, how do we draw the best out of people rather than the worst?
Do our choices lead toward and help contribute to a world that we really want to live in because it is fair, because everyone's included, everyone has opportunity?
Every right is grounded in a duty. Just as water flows out of a spring, rights flow out of the spring of duty.
When we come to learn about these issues of poverty, environmental degradation, systematic oppression, I mean, what do we do? How can we be productive agents for change in a world that doesn't have to be the way it is?
The wisdom of compassion as this great moral emotion is that your community is only as good as the people who are worse off. You take your capacity to care for others and put their interests above your own, and then you just broaden it out through contemplation or actual altruism, however, to other people, other groups, distant groups, other species, and then ultimately, you know, all sentient beings.
The ethical obligations that we have today are different from those of our parents or grandparents. Today we have instant communications and we have rapid transport, so we can help much more rapidly. Imagine that you're walking across a park and you pass a shallow pond. The pond is empty except for a small child who's fallen in and seems to be in danger of drowning. You can't see the parents or a babysitter. Perhaps your first thought is, well, I should rush into the pond and pull out that child who's going to drown otherwise. But then you think, wait a minute, just this morning I put on my most expensive pair of shoes and I don't have time to get them off. If I rush into the pond with them, they're going to get ruined. So what should you do? Would you be an ethical person if you did walk on and ignore the child? I'm hoping that you're thinking, I would never weigh a child's life against the cost of a pair of shoes. Then maybe you should also think about the fact that there are children dying, not right in front of you, but in poor nations.
What Darwin did is he looked at humans and he said, you know, what is our defining characteristic? And his thesis was that humans, the strongest instinct, is our capacity for sympathy. We're not a really strong species, we don't have big fangs, we're not, you know, what we needed is to be sympathetic. The evidence on being generous and being giving is irrefutable. acts of generosity and caregiving make you happier. They make you stronger. They make you live longer.
We are one human family. And if you think about being a member of a family, what does that mean? We don't elevate a brother over another brother or a sister over a brother. We are responsible for each other. It isn't just a matter of transferring things from here to there or of imposing boundaries, you know, thinking of ourselves as separate. We are all connected.
It's about creating hope and returning people's dignity. You know, we've lost it many ways. We can say we have lost it to every corner of the world. We have lost it to Europe during the scramble for the partition of Africa. We have lost it to Europe during colonization. We have lost it through transfer of mineral resources to support big multinationals out there. Many institutions there are thriving. Many economies are thriving because of raw materials from this soil, from Africa.
I feel like being with people, it's like you are very much connected to the world.
Hello? Today?
It's just, you know, hard to comprehend what my life would have been otherwise had I not taken that leap, not taken that step to start this. And, you know, also just at the same time, you know, not knowing where my life would have been, but also think about these girls that I consider my children, where they would have been. And what situations they would have been in, if they would have been alive, if they would have had a future, if they would have had hope.
Nakwambia ukweli, ukimjua Mungu, sister, hakuna kitu naona kigumu. Yani mimi nimeona maisha yangu, Mungu ameweka hayo, haya yale naishi. Yani sioni hata kama, yani nimezoea. Ninaendelea nasonga juu ni maisha ya kuendelea si ati anasimama hapana maisha nasonga maisha yanaendelea.
Each one of us has a huge amount of power to help the world or to hurt the world.
What are we spending our lives in? Is it an investment in something that's a loving act or a destructive act? It really, really became very clear that you can commit yourself to one or the other.
Sometimes people assume that when you do something that's important and courageous, that's just that you kind of go forward and you just say, yeah, I'll do that. But again, in looking at their lives, there's always struggle. Martin King struggled. And I'm here because somebody was willing to do likewise.
Laila.
The most meaningful part of this work is the fact that it is trying to elevate the people from a lower ground into some elevated ground. I was just born around where that powerhouse is built. That is my home. So I live within the community and we work with them. This is the proposed Nyakach women fish traders, fish processing and filleting plant. We have started doing fabrication for windows and doors, and the material are still here. And unfortunately, the fourth funding, which was supposed to finalize all that, amounting to about 5.6 million shillings, did not come from our partners in Europe.
White elephants are basically projects that are either left incomplete or are completed but are not being used.
You can see the lintels, they were very huge and very strong. So for the last 6 years or so, the thing stalled. And that is why you are calling it a white elephant. Funds came to a halt and we stopped there. This is where we intended to put a retail shop where fish should be sold from here through that passage. The retail shop. We just remained with plastering, putting up the windows and plastering the thing and starting off. So many projects which have stalled in this country, most of them are funded by organizations which come with particular projects they want to do with the communities. But it was not a considered decision of the community. So because people are in need of doing projects and in need of money, they would rush into making quick proposals in order to get the money. And as a result of lack of proper preparation, no proper training, no proper structures put on place, administrative structures, at the end of the day, you find the project stalled. They gave us three quarters. The last one did not come. So we have waited, we have written letters, we have even gone to Brussels, and those people went underground. That is as a result of not being very transparent. And here we call it corruption.
10 years ago, when you're probably a little still younger and you are growing at a couple of inches every night. So you had a new pair of shoes and probably you have three or four and you wear it, say, one pair, you love one so much, you wear it again after about 2 months and you walk a little bit and it's pinching you and it's quite uncomfortable. Now, anyone else who walks around you does not know the pain you are feeling inside those shoes. It could be pinching your toe, it could be pinching your heel, it could be pinching the side of your foot. It is only you who experiences a challenge who can figure out which part of your life that challenge affects most.
I think there's been a trend in the way that the West has tried to help by thinking that we can solve the problems of the world's poor. We cannot do that. The only way to solve poverty is when you enable and equip local individuals to change and transform their lives and their communities. The traditional model of aid, of a handout mentality, keeps people on their knees. I think the old model of development said, we have a lot of money, we have a lot of things, and so the way that we can help people living in poverty is by giving our stuff away. And so that, even the founding of Hope International, it was a model where a church here in Pennsylvania said, we've got a lot of stuff, we want to give it away, and they would travel around and they would give things. After 2 years of this partnership, the church said, we appreciate your help, we appreciate your partnership, but you got to stop with the handouts. But they recognized there were issues of dependency that were creeping up. It was actually hurting some of the local businesses. If you're a shoe tailor and suddenly you get this influx of a gazillion pairs of shoes in your community, how are you going to compete in a market like that?
if you look at development from a much broader perspective, it's something the whole world is engaged in. You know, we're part of an ever-advancing civilization, and the purpose of what we're doing is to allow for the material and spiritual empowerment of all the people of the world.
I've come to assume that development efforts have always been around. That development as a field, with specialists in institutions, was just a natural occurrence. I was surprised when I found out that development was actually a term and a field created by the United States after World War II as a security strategy. In 1947, Harry S. Truman proclaimed to the world that the United States will focus on industrialization, technology, and science to bring people out of poverty. This was largely in part because of the spread of Soviet influence around the globe, and it was seen as a way to curb communist influence over what was called the Third World. The First World referred to capitalist US and Western Europe, the Second World Communist Soviet Union, and the Third World was everyone else. Vying for influence over the Third World meant stemming the spread of communist influence. And because of this, development was a part of a larger U.S. containment security strategy. As a result, it left very little room for outside voices or alternative views of development. This view of development relied upon a Western model of modernization, or the concentration of resources in large cities, hoping that the focus on a few industries, or export crops, would lead to overall prosperity. Americans would know this as the trickle-down effect. Societies were supposed to go from traditional agricultural-based economies to societies of mass consumption. This turned out to be somewhat of a failure, because it was found that this one-size-fits-all model does not work in every case. Development that didn't take into account local or country-specific contexts was not sustainable. To find room in the international market, countries were encouraged to concentrate on particular crops based on environmental or comparative advantage, in a large-scale, technologically supported fashion. Large farms growing only one crop needed mechanized tools like combines and other machinery. These large monocultures produced a significant number of insects, which subsequently led to an increase in the use of insecticides and eventually desertification of the soil. Throughout this process, the Third World had to rely heavily on American technology, such as genetically modified seeds, combines, tractors, and equipment for watering. The reality was that farmers ended up losing their land, as well as their ability to decide the direction of their families' lives. Decades later, in spite of the gross failure of these development initiatives, the debts associated with these programs are still being paid off. In 1970, the world's poorest countries owed $25 billion. By mid-2000, it was over half $1 trillion. All the original debts have been paid off, but the interest on those loans are still being paid.
Bye.
What we're trying to build at JBFC is a holistic care campus that focuses in four main areas: education, primary all the way up through secondary and high school education, refuge for orphaned and abandoned girls. We also have agriculture and livestock programs, and then we're also expecting to open a medical clinic soon, so we'll be working with healthcare. We really have looked at this campus as kind of a partial solution to helping end rural extreme poverty. We really looked at the issues and institutions that are not in rural Africa and said, you know, how do we make that a reality? Children need communities to thrive. I think children need communities to really help raise them and to help really make them into the adults that you'd be proud of as a parent. Our biggest shortcomings as an organization right now is just really our capacity. We have so many kids and girls on our waiting list to be able to come and live with us. We have so many kids on our waiting list at the school. We're never going to be able to accept all of the people on our waiting list, and even if we did, the waiting list would triple after that. That's something that, you know, we definitely struggle with as an organization. It's extremely hard when you have girls coming to your organization or coming through social welfare and social welfare calling, and, you know, I have this really desperate case, can you take it? And it's like, no, we really don't have room, we really don't have space. You know, we've had students crying in our office, and, you know, that's really heartbreaking just to know that, you know, I'm here to help people like this, and I can't help this individual right now.
Suppose you had no image of a big city, but every now and then you got the first 3 minutes of the 6 o'clock news about cities like New York, Philadelphia, Chicago, and so forth. And suppose that those clips of news were the only things that you had to formulate your image about these cities. How many of you would visit and expect to go home alive? People get just bits and pieces, and usually these are sensational kind of news. And so you cannot blame people for thinking of Africa as some place where people are always fighting everywhere, or there is wildlife everywhere.
They were born in Africa. You had nothing to do with where you were born. They had nothing to do with where they were born. It's not okay that half of the world does not have enough to live on. It's not okay that a billion people live in extreme poverty. That's not okay. And if you were one of the individuals that were born into that circumstance, I think you'd want someone to care.
When we see hunger on the landscape, we're inclined to see that immediately as a scarcity of skills or a scarcity of resources. And so often when we see hunger in a landscape, it's because of a scarcity of a certain degree of people having power over their lives.
My mother passed away. Then my father came to this land. Then he passed away. Then you are with my grandmother. Her also passed away.
Sometimes we can go to school. And by that time, it was a day of school. And yet we do have even food at all. So by that time, you are thinking of two things at the same time. At that time you are thinking of school, I'm learning. And also you are thinking of home, what you are going to do home to have food for night that night. By that time, sometimes it's coming difficult for us.
this is my photo. Somebody cheat me to take a photo, and he went with him to look for sponsorship. Then, until now, he has not come back for the sponsorship he went to look. I did not get any help from him.
When people are suffering, the dignity of humankind is touched. When you are not working for the dignity of the poor, you are not working for dignity at all. You see much more the life on a poor level, but you see the life full of meaning, and you see the life of dignity.
But now, I don't know my mother.
During my early work in Tanzania, when I was at the boys' home, one of the biggest things I noticed were just the lack of resources, the lack of opportunities available for girls. And you would hear horror stories of young girls being sold into brothels, of having to sell themselves on the street, being forced into domestic servitude just so that they could get by. That was kind of the catalyst for choosing girls. There was nothing in this area being done. There wasn't a place for these girls to call a home.
My sister's keeper. It is an organization that I co-founded with three other women and then eventually five other women following a trip in 2001 to what is now known as South Sudan to explore a very elaborate underground railroad that was developed by locals to retrieve their loved ones who had been enslaved during that 22-year conflict with Northern Sudan. I've been impressed with the injustice that women around the world experience. And I know lots of people experience it, men and women, but in particular, the extent to which it seems to be disproportionately on the shoulders and on the backs of women and children. And then I came back here, and you look around and you say, oh my God, we see elements of that even here. And so what I realize is it's not just about genocide over there. It's about violence against women there and here. And so to stand up for women over there is also to stand up for women over here. And certainly all of us have to say something. And I'm saying something.
Women and children are the worst victims of ecological degradation, of climate catastrophes, of wars, because they are more vulnerable. But in a patriarchal society, men get the privilege. So if there's very little food, they will get the food. If there is violence, they'll move away. The women and children get left behind. It's very much like the Titanic, even though the principle was women and children first into the lifeboats. The reality was the poor women and the poor children were locked in while the elite escaped in the lifeboats.
There's a Swahili proverb that we love that if you educate a boy, you've created a man. But if you educate a girl, you've empowered the community. Women are the heads of family, and families are what make up a community.
Women are the food producers of Africa as they are the food producers of the world, but African women even more. We need to put women's traditional knowledge at the center, and nothing in the world says traditional knowledge is stagnant.
So many women in this community, they never had a chance to be educated. And so now, even adult literacy is possible when women have more time.
Bold, courageous, outspoken, and clear, loving, warm, kind, considerate women working across difference for the sake of our children and our children's children to build a functional planet. I'm very interested in inspiring a revolution. I'm hoping to be part of a whole army of misbehaving women so we can take on all of the problems of the planet and just solve them. And that's kind of exciting at this season in my life.
We have to care. We have to be brother's keeper. Reason being that if you don't care for your neighbor, you know what happens next. If your neighbor slept hungry the first day, maybe he or she will tolerate. If your neighbor slept hungry the third day, they will break into your house and steal whatever food you have. It becomes insecure for you. If you care for your neighbor becomes your security, your neighbor becomes your friend.
We believe that all the human beings are the same in the world, apart from their culture and the way of life. The life is very simple in Maasai land, especially when there's no drought, because cattle are the Maasai backbone. We get everything from cattle. We get food from them, like blood, milk, meat, hide to sleep on, and also we need them for dowry to pay women. And even we get houses as well from them, because we used cow dung to smear our houses with. Before the drought myself, I have 75 cattle, and now I have 12 cows. I'm a father of 8 children. What I want my future to be, I want like to take them, if I have like enough money to send them to school, I send them all to school.
I will pray when I was like squatting to wait for my God to come and pick me up.
we do water projects in rural communities. Most of the areas where we work are semi-arid areas, so areas where there's very little permanent water, and water is a huge issue for people and their livestock. We also did food relief. We're also doing an education program right now on the issues of livestock. And that impacts everybody in the Maasai community, and many people are interested in attending those workshops. Challenges on the ground, working in a culture that's I'm not from the community, so there's things that sometimes I really need help from people who are part of the community to just tell me what's really going on here, so I can get a feeling of how the community's feeling about something. Sometimes you face opposition. Sometimes you think that this is something that should be so clearly good for the community, and either people they can even oppose you.
Even when you are absolutely sure that you know exactly what would be good for the people, sometimes there are some cultural issues that you still have to be aware of, or at least find out, because you may think people are against development, but actually it's not.
We keep them in form of loans, small loans. The family receives a cow, which is in calf, and the family will pay through passing on the gift. They pass on the gift by donating the offspring to another family. In that sense, they will have completed their loans. If it is chicken, it is several chickens, every chick will have to be paid by another chick. If it is through beekeeping, a family receiving a beehive will sell honey and give out money to buy another beehive to be given to another family within the neighborhood.
So you don't get any money back?
It is not coming back to us. It is rotating within the communities. The way we do it is farmers organize themselves into groups and they apply to HEVA for support in terms of livestock. We select the farmers and once we agree, we train them or management of the livestock they want.
Those are the ones that I was given by Haifa International. There was 11 hens and 2 cocks. They lay eggs. After laying eggs, I brood them here. You can come and see them. Welcome. I do brood them here. This I've got 10 eggs. This one are 10 eggs. There's another one here. This is the smallest hen I have. These have 6 eggs, 10 eggs.
HEVA model is more sustainable because the families own the livestock or the skills right from the word go, and it stays with the communities. It is not something that you help them and go away and you, like hardware or opening a road or a dispensary which is not maintained. The families have that responsibility of feeding the cow or the chicken or the pig to produce, and because they can also, they have interest in maintaining the livestock.
After getting those hens, they produce eggs. I sell eggs. I give my children, that is my grandson, I give them eggs, they do eat, we sell them, and we also eat egg. I buy a sheep, I buy a goat, so that is the product from the hen.
There is a moral obligation by farmers to move out of poverty, and they really want to be part of a donor community. Everybody wants to be a donor, somehow. So if a farmer receives a cow, and he's told that is a cow on loan and is going to pay back through bringing the offspring, and that offspring will be given another farmer as a loan, that farmer feels proud for having donated an animal to another farmer, another poor farmer. And then he's going to train the farmer who is receiving the offspring because he has a knowledge on animal husbandry. So that one is a spiritual thing within the human nature. You have been supported And you now you want to support us as well.
For the help of my children. I even sell hens and eggs. That is my last born son, and he's in the college. I do pay those college with the product from the hen. I'm so glad. I'm so happy. Yes.
Now scientists, with thanks to technological advances, are trying to find different parts of our nervous system that help us be good to other people. This fascinating bundle of nerves that we study in our lab called the vagus nerve. It's this big bundle of nerves that really goes from the top of your head all the way down to the base of your spinal cord, right alongside your spinal cord. Now, here's what's amazing about the vagus nerve. First of all, is it helps you vocalize. Second of all, when it's activated, it leads to the release of oxytocin receptors, or oxytocin. Third, it really calms your heart. So when you're feeling sort of calm and content and connected, the vagus nerve is slowing your heart rate down. And there's a thesis that the vagus nerve, given these functions and given the fact that it's unique to mammals, is part of our nervous system that evolved, that was shaped by evolution, to help us take care of others. And it makes you feel that you share common humanity with other people.
So it's not something that is just a kind of a handout. It's something where people are really involved. And from the beginning, we also say to people that this is going to be something that we're going to work with you to do, and then it's going to be handed over to you.
The very, very honest NGOs, this is the only way that they can reach to these people.
The biggest obstacle to making change is feeling that the power in the world is so tightly held that there's no place for me, that my voice doesn't count for anything. It is fundamentally a feeling of powerlessness, which is the greatest problem in the world today.
This project is my first high school level choir piece, and it's a cantata. So normally, if we think about cantatas, we're pretty much talking about Bach is probably the first thing that people are gonna think about. And that's a relatively short piece for choir, some instruments, and maybe some vocal solos. And usually the text for those things comes from the Bible or some type of religious text. This is a little bit different because I'm taking text from English language interviews with refugees from Darfur, and I've kind of snipped things together and rearranged them and put them together for this piece. If everything works out, you know, in the best possible sense, people are going to be really affected because music has that power to, you know, when they're in the audience, so they're going to be hearing about it for the first time, possibly, and also it's going to be moving them. Every word that they're going to be singing is something that someone actually said. It's not so distant anymore. You're saying the same words, and also everybody in the same room as you that's standing around you is saying the same words that somebody in a different continent, in a different time, in a different place said in a real time of need and in a real time of desperation. I'm going to guess that the vast majority of the people who are approached with this piece don't know a whole lot about what's going on there. And there's going to be a lot of parents that are sitting in the audience who don't know a lot about what's going on there. And my hope is that these people in the audience and the people singing it are going to be curious enough to at least Google search this and find out what's going on. The whole cantata itself is called Beautiful Rain. And that comes from this line of text. I would not wait until tomorrow. I want this beautiful rain to fall on my fields today. So this is someone singing about if there was peace, how he would go back. Why everybody doesn't think that this is an important issue than it is for me to ask why I think it's an important issue. Because to me, this is so much more pressing than most of the things that we have to deal with in our day-to-day life. I think this project was a way for me to be able to do music and also feel like I was giving something back and telling people what this issue was. I'm definitely not single-handedly saving Darfur. But with all of these things, if everybody just does a little bit, it really makes a huge difference. If you figure there are, I don't know, 6 billion people on the planet right now, 300 million or so of them are Americans, what we do in our country affects way more than just our country. Each one of us has a huge amount of power to help the world or to hurt the world.
I was speaking with our first president of the board at the time, and he said, you know, I think if you really feel like you're being called into this work, then you just need to take that step and do it. And he said, and people will follow.
I think so many people have that feeling of wanting to do something, wanting to help in some way. You know, you could go somewhere for a couple of months, and you could go with your family and do a service project. You could go through your church. You could go through Habitat. You could go through all those things. Those kind of experiences are invaluable.
Folks are often surprised at the generosity of Americans. We're among the most generous people on the planet. The issue with aid, however, is that a majority of Americans believe that some 20 to 30% of the total federal budget goes to foreign aid. When you ask Americans how much of the federal budget they think we should be spending on foreign aid, the average response is maybe 5, 6, 7% of the federal budget. The reality is that less than 1% of the federal budget goes to foreign aid to poor countries who may need it the most.
The sun provides us every day 15,000 times the energy that the world is now using in fossil fuels. So the nature of life is possibility.
There's support here, there's food, there's a loving mother, a loving father, 10 loving uncles, 10 loving aunts, and it really makes them self-confident. It makes, it's empowering for them.
Hawana fedha ya kuwatosha. Wanaweza hata wakalala njaa. Na mimi huku tu naweza nikala wala hata sijui je kama nyumbani hawali au wanakula. Nilikuwa na miaka 10. Nikaenda tu kutembea tu mne mtaani. Kama tu kutembea na kuomba hela na kulala nje. Sasa yupo hivi baba. Huyo baba akaja akaniambiaje? Akaja akaniambia hivi uje basi nitafutie msichana. Sasa msichana wa nini? Wakuwa tu nalala naye. Kasemaje? Aha, sio. Nikaenda nikamfuata huyo waande. Sasa huyo baba akanipa shilingi 10,000. Aponipa shilingi 10,000, huyo tena waande akapewa shilingi 40,000. Nikamwambiaje? Akaniambiaje nishikilizie, nikamshikilizia. Sasa akaenda sasa mimi nimelala sasa. Sasa zile hela nikazificha. Nilipozificha akaja sasa akaniuzaje pili hela ziko wapi? Kasemaje lilikuja hivi limlevi likaninyang'anya. Kumbe nimezificha. Napanga mile ni nakula wali. Labda siku hiyo nakula pilau na nyama ya kuku. Nakula. Sasa hivyo paka hadi hela zikaisha. Sasa nikaja nikarudi wapi? Nikarudi huku Mwanza.
We called her into a meeting with the whole staff and just talked to her about her behavior at school, her behavior with men, and had to kind of take the family approach and show her that not only do the women at this campus care about her, but the men as well. And the men are very supportive of her and think of her as their daughter. She got emotional, but we've seen a vast change since then.
My good friend and colleague heard about slavery, and she invited myself and my husband to go along. I really didn't know a whole lot about Sudan and South Sudan. And it was a hard trip. It was hard to hear the stories when you've been chronically oppressed, and the way that you manage to keep going is to, you can't go into the emotion. You got to stick to the facts. But it was, the stories of courage were so inspiring. There was one day that was especially hard. I saw a young boy in a crowd of several hundred of these returning slaves whose face was particularly deformed. And I made the assumption that it was a congenital deformity, but in fact, that young boy who at the time was around 12, 4 years earlier, had been charged with keeping the cattle. That's a typical chore for young boys. Because he lost a cow, his master, in his anger, took an axe and chopped off the boy's nose. And the image that I saw was what was left. He lost a cow. And it's a hard picture to look at, but I show it to people and give them the heads up, and I show it to people because I say, this is the face of genocide. And I lay in my tent that night, just really crying out and crying, right? It's not what comes naturally to me. I am by nature extremely shy. And so to be in a place where I was going to endure controversy was part of my struggle. but it wasn't about me. Just like with my ancestors, it really wasn't about them. So I was able to dip into the same place that Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth and Fannie Lou Hamer dipped into and say yes to what's a hard way to go. We don't come from people who shrink back. We come from people who endure and persevere.
Tulikuwa Tanzania, nilikuwa kwa kambi, tulikuwa kwa kambi sote. Hapo yani hata kulala ilikuwa shida, ukweli kabisa. Nasikia wakati wewe ulikuwa mbaya. Wakati wewe tulikuwa Tanzania. Sikukuwa naona kweli kama bado nitaka. Nilikuwa naona hata mimi wataniua. Juu walikuwa wanapanga kuniua, Mungu anawazuia. Hapo nilikuwa na wazazi wote wawili, nilikuwa na mandugu na madada, na wote walikufa huko, walikufia huko. Sasa siwezi ati nikafurahia, sasa naweza furahia nini? Nilikasirika, kwanza nilisikia vibaya sana, juu nabaki peke yangu, hakuna mtu wa kukuambia hata ukianguka hapo pole, hakuna. Sista, sijui nikuambia nini. Nakwambia, yeah. Nakwambia ukweli kabisa, ukisikia wanakuja kukuua wewe, yeah. Unaenda kujificha mahali, unatoka hapo. Yani unaona wengine wanakimbia, wanakimbisha mtu, unatoka hapo pia wewe unajificha hapo mstuni. Unaenda unafika kwa mtu unamuomba akufungulie mlango uingie, yeah. Saa zingine anakukataa, anakwambia hapana, enda usije ukaniletea shida. Eh? Hata mimi nitauawa na wewe. Eh? Unaona hiyo? Kuna usiku mmoja. Usiku mmoja. Nilikuwa hapo mstuni. Kama nimebeba huyu Fabrice, alikuwa na miezi mbili wakati huu. Nikatoka, hata kwa nyumba hatukukua tunakaa sasa. Nikakaa mstuni, alafu nikasikia. Kweli sasa imefika wakati sasa, imefika mwisho. Nikatoka hapo nikaenda kwa mtu alikuwa rafiki, nikamuomba anifungulie. Akafungua, nikakunyingia kwa nyumba, akafunga mlango. Na kuambia ukweli kabisa, yani nilifikiria nikasema, Mungu wewe kama unaona kweli imefika mwisho, siishie hapo kama wajanifikia. Nililala hapo, asubuhi yake nikaamkia hapo, nikashinda hapo mchana, mwenye nyumba sasa akasema watu watoke, tuko marafiki wakikuja kwetu sasa watukose, watajua tu tumeenda kwao, tutoke hapo, tuende. Hiyo ni kutufukuza, naona. Sasa hiyo sikukuwa najua mahali mimi nitaelekea, lakini kuna rafiki yangu msichana mwingine alikuwa naishi ngambo hii. Alikuja kunichukua hapo, huyo maisha yangu sitawahi msahau, ni kama wewe, vile ni sitawahi msahau.
What I've come to recognize is that I stand on the shoulders, if you will, of men and women who, in the face of great danger, refuse to give up and continue to persevere. So I often think of myself as my ancestors' dream and their promise.
Kitu watu huwa hawajajua kitu kimoja. Kwa ndoa si ati uende ukae na maisha mazuri. Juu wakati huwa mnafunga ndoa wanakuambia umemkubali, kwa mazuri ama kwa mabaya. juu yote yanaambatana. Si ati kwani umefika mbinguni, hapa ni duniani. Na tena mimi niliona ni kama Mungu anataka kuona kweli kama nampenda ndio anipatie hiyo.
Chai. Mm. Tuende chimwira hapa.
Mm-hmm. Yalikuwa maisha mazuri. Unaona kulikuwa na pesa, kulikuwa na kila kitu hapo. Mm. Sasa ilifika wakati sasa tukatoka huko tukaacha kila kitu tukakuja. Nikarudisha watu nyumbani ndio sisi tukahepa tukakuja hapa. Ndio sasa maisha yakaendelea miaka miwili sasa nikaanza kugonjeka. Halafu sasa wakati aligonjeka sasa maisha yalibadilika kabisa. Sasa naona ni maisha ya kuenda hospitali, kurudi, hivyo hivyo. Alafu sasa ndio pesa zikaisha. Tulikuwa tunasaidiana tena, tulikuwa na kaduka hapo nje. Alafu sasa wakati ameenda hospitali, amerudi, hivyo hivyo, amerazwa. Pesa zote zikaisha. Ndio sasa nikaweka sasa ako kakiwasika, ako kakibanda hapo nje. Maisha yakaendelea hivyo hivyo. Na tukapatana na GRS ndio ikatusaidia. Amekuwa mgonjwa miaka 11. Alianza 99. Alafu akaenda hospitali, akalazwa St. Mary's. Ndio walijua sasa ako na hiyo ugonjwa ya moyo. Naelewa sasa. Eh? Alinipenda pia yeye hata mimi wakati nilikuwa. Hiyo vita ilikuwa imenikujia mimi kunimaliza sana sana. Hiyo. Yeye anataka kunitoa hai. Sasa alitoa pesa yote alikuwa nayo. Yaani anaenda akinilipia tu hapo kwa barabara. Wanasema huyu hapana hamwendi na yeye. Anatoa pesa. Hata kama ni 10,000 anatoa hiyo. Ananilipia. Sasa mtu kama huyo kusema ukweli, ni nini? Unaweza mnyima? Alitoa yote tukabaki hivyo. Na tukasema mahali tutafika tutasaidiana bado ndio tuishi. Hatukukua na chochote. Watu walikuwa wananiuliza, nyinyi mumeumbwa aje? Mbona unaweza kukaa hapo na mgonjwa? Hakuna kitu unafaidika hapo, hakuna raha, hakuna nini. Kama wangekuwa ni wengine, sasa, wa mama sasa majirani, yani hapo ni story inaendelea. Sasa, kama angekuwa ni mimi, hata nakwambia ukweli siwezi, ningekuwa nimeshaenda tayari. Naambia hapana, hiyo kazi ni Mungu alipenda nifanye. Juu hata ile dunia utaenda ni ya Mungu bado.
So that is the situation, a bit of consolata. Yes, that they came from a rich background, but now they are very poor. But they manage and they survive, you know. And I think one part of that story of consolata which touched me when I met her, suddenly, her husband is lying there, cannot speak properly, cannot, yeah, you have seen him. And suddenly she took him, and you realized the love. And when she stood beside me, I looked at her husband, she looked with me at her husband, and suddenly she said, "Father, you don't know how much I love this man."
Mama,
Nitafaulu na pia nitawasaidia wazazi wangu. Ni wa baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Ni wa baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Hallelujah. Ni wa baraka. Hallelujah. Ni wa baraka. Asifiwe.
Wa baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Ni wa baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Hallelujah.
Haleluya, ni wa upendo. Haleluya, ni wa upendo. Asifiwe.
Wa neema, Mungu wetu ni wa neema. Ni wa neema, Mungu wetu ni wa neema. Haleluya, ni wa neema. Haleluya, ni wa neema. Asifiwe.
Baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Ni wa baraka, Mungu wetu ni wa baraka. Haleluya, ni wa baraka. Haleluya, ni wa baraka. Asifiwe.
Wa upendo, Mungu wetu ni wa upendo. Ni wa upendo, Mungu wetu ni wa upendo. Haleluya, ni wa upendo. Asifiwe.
It's definitely the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my life, and I can't even imagine my life without these girls.
What you need to be asking yourself is, to what extent is that person I am so keen to help empowered to be part of the decision making for this help I want to give him? Is their voice heard?
So I think we all need to find our own Sudan. My Sudan is 8,000-9,000 miles away. But it's the place that takes you out of what's familiar and what's comfortable. And Martin King says that you haven't really lived until you've found something worth dying for. And for me, it's worth losing my life if it's about justice.